All right, so we have broken down our casting technologies down into two gigantic groups. One is permanent mold casting, which we'll talk about today. The other group would include things like sand casting and investment casting. Those are expendable mold processes. So in these, this giant classification of permanent mold casting, essentially you have a mold that you can use more than one time. You can use it over and over again. Now, there's a little bit of confusion because there is a single permanent mold casting process that is part of this bigger group of processes. So we have these permanent mold casting processes where we say in general that the mold is reusable over and over again. But we have these different types of permanent mold casting processes. And you see there's die casting, centrifugal casting, continuous casting, and also another one at this level called permanent mold casting. So that's a little confusing, but just understand that it's a big general category, but there's also a specific process called permanent mold casting. Also gets called gravity die casting, which is maybe a little confusing because there's also a process called die casting. So there's just no good way to break these out, but that's what we're going to do. All right, this specific process called permanent mold casting, that's actually what was in the image up here at the front. So we have a big mold made out of graphite or steel or cast iron, and we can cast ferrous and, well, in graphite molds we can cast like cast iron, but generally you cast non-ferrous metals in a permanent mold. Talking about these permanent mold castings, this specific process. So like I said, it's also known as gravity die casting. The other die casting, we will just call die casting. Some people will call that pressure die casting to make a distinction, and that might be a good way to do it. All right, so like I said, the molds are a lot of times cast iron, steel, bronze, graphite, and they can go together different ways. One common way to do it is to hinge the mold, like you saw earlier in that title slide. Also, you can have sort of a sliding action, sort of like an injection mold would look like, or even it would look a little bit like a die casting arrangement where you have the molds slide apart. So the way this works is the molds get preheated, and they're generally lined with a sort of refractory release agent, which is called a mold wash. All right, so the metal is then heated. And then it's poured into the mold, and this can take, there are different ways of getting the liquid metal into the mold, and we'll talk about some of those. But essentially what you want to try to do is get the metal into the mold, have the part itself solidify, have the sprue and runner system solidify like we talked about. We want the shrinkage to happen outside of the part itself. This is a vent in this arrangement here. So you pour in here, fill up from the bottom, and vent out of the top. This is a sort of an internal riser in here. And then soon after the part solidifies, you want to go ahead and remove it out of the mold because a part like this, as it starts to shrink, as it cools down, it will tend to, you might wind up with hot tears because this is kind of a arrangement here that's going to lend itself to hot tears. All right, so you're going to use permanent mold casting when you need a little higher production rate than you'd get with sand casting, and you need maybe better finish requirements than you would with sand casting, but you're not really ready to bite the bullet and go all the way to a really expensive arrangement, which would be die casting. So die casting is going to be a lot more complex than this, and you know, more complexity in the molds, but this is kind of a good middle ground between die casting and sand casting, is this realm of permanent mold castings. All right, like I said, there are different ways of getting the melt into the mold. This is a bottom gated arrangement here where you pour the metal in and it's going to fill from the bottom. And really what you're trying to do in any of these arrangements is to minimize the turbulence that happens. You know, when the metal flows, the liquid metal flows in a turbulent way, then it's going to dissolve gases in it, and then those gases are going to come out of solution during the solidification process, and they're going to create porosity. So Generally, any way that you look at how you get the metal into a permanent mold is generally dealing with ways of minimizing porosity. And in some cases, one design might work better than another. For instance, here, it looks like the bottom gated permanent mold arrangement might give you a little better result than the tilt pour in this particular case. But in a different case, you might get less stirring out of a tilt pour than you would out of a bottom gated pour. Two other ways of doing this is to have a low pressure system where you actually pump air pressure into the container that has the liquid metal in it, and that then will fill up the mold from the bottom. This is a pretty popular way of doing this. You'll see this and the tilt pour, both very popular ways of doing permanent mold casting. Another way is vacuum casting, and there are vacuum castings also done with plaster mold castings, but in this case, this is just a permanent mold casting, and you're using vacuum to draw up the molten metal into the casting. And like I said, these are good for smaller, any of these are good for smaller castings, generally something, you know, that you'd be able to carry around in your hand. There are a couple of videos in the slides. Probably be a good idea to go and watch some of those and get the idea of how this process works. And the advantage is to remember that you can get these near net shape. So a net shape part, I don't think we've mentioned in this class yet, but a net shape part is one that doesn't require any machining at all. So or any post-processing, any finishing. So like it in a Lego plant, when the Lego mold opens up, the Legos that come out of that mold are net-shaped parts. They require no further processing, unless maybe it's one of the little heads and you have to do some pad printing or something on to get the face on. But the blocks come out as net-shaped parts. Well, permanent mold casting is what you would call a near-net shape, because generally there's a little bit of finishing to do to get the gates removed, things like that. In general, with die castings, they will kind of break free pretty easily from the runner system. But it's a little bit neater than, say, sand casting. All right, so a little finished machining needed. The molds, obviously, you can do over and over again. You can reuse the molds. You get better surface finish than you would with sand casting. You get more consistent dimensions because you don't have to go out and make a pattern, make a mold each time. And also, something I haven't mentioned is that you get a good chilling effect from the mold, and this allows for directional solidification, which is something that you don't really get with sand casting, because sand casting, the molds are pretty insulative. In permanent mold casting, it will tend to pull the heat out of the casting, and you wind up a lot of times with a little better grain structure than you would with sand casting. All right, so you are going to pay more up front to get a mold, and that means to make this cost effective, generally you need pretty high production volume. So if you're only making one or two of a part, you're definitely not going to be doing permanent mold casting. If you're doing 30 parts a day, then maybe that's something to look at. So you are going to have more tooling cost, and the complexity is going to be limited. So you don't have, think about like pipe fittings have kind of the look of a part that might be permanent mold cast. So, you can get, there are some, I've seen some stuff online that's fairly complex, but in general, it's more of the limited complexity kind of bracket fitting type. Type part. All right, so die casting. If you're familiar with injection molding, I'm going to go ahead and say it kind of looks like it's similar to injection molding, where you have two halves of a mold, and you squeeze the metal in. In this case, it's metal, and it will take the form of the mold, and then the mold opens up. You eject the part out. Now, that sounds like injection molding, but I don't want to use that term because there is a separate process that's not at all related to die casting that's called metal injection molding, all right? And that is a completely different thing. It actually involves injection molding equipment, but you're using a powdered metal and a resin binder, and then but that's something that we will talk about when we talk about powder processes. So even though die casting kind of, in theory anyway, looks a little like injection molding of plastics, it is not the metal version of injection molding. Or at least, well, it kind of is, but it's not the thing that's called metal injection molding. That is a completely different process. All right, like I said, also, this is sometimes called pressure die casting, because really and truly, if you're doing permanent mold casting like we just talked about, that is sort of a die, and it's kind of hard to distinguish. But anyway, if we just call it die casting, we're talking about this particular die casting process. All right, so the molds are used over and over again. This is a much higher production process than even permanent mold casting. And as you might expect, the tooling is more expensive, but you're going to be able to get a whole lot more complexity. You're going to get really, really nice surface finish on these. But you're going to be limited to lower melting temperature alloys. The one that's used most commonly is zinc. So when you see something and it says genuine metal, or if it says genuine metal or genuine die-cast metal, then it's zinc. So zinc kind of gets called pot metal a lot of times, and I think maybe at one time there was pot metal where you took sort of the lower melting temperature scrap metal in the plant and you would mix it together. But anyway, it's a lot of times zinc gets called pot metal, but it's not really pot metal. It's generally a pretty well-known zinc alloy. Now you can die cast aluminum, and you can die cast magnesium, but really the poster child is zinc, and it's a real nice low temperature alloy. It's got good strength, and a lot of times it gets mistaken for aluminum, not because it's that much lighter, than steel, but because it's generally you have these little small parts, and it's kind of hard to judge the density of something like a matchbox car or some small die cast part. Now, when you're designing a product to be die-cast, you want to keep a few things in mind. Number one, really for any of these permanent mold casting processes, you need to have some kind of a draft. So this component right here, this little junction box type thing, I have down here next to it, this Mitutoyo V block has got a nice vertical edge on it. So this edge is completely vertical, and you can get a good idea of how much draft is built into this product. So the draft is this angled this taper that we talked about when we introduced casting. So here it becomes a real important thing, and like I said, also with the other permanent mold casting that we talked about, you have to have a draft angle to have this thing turn loose of the mold nice and easily. You also want to avoid undercuts. These are problematic. And also cores. So this part would require some cores to come in from the side. So this, if you just open this up in one direction, you're not going to get all of the detail. So you see you have some detail in here that's in a different direction. These holes that go in from the side had to have something solid to solidify around. So there was a core that slid in from the side here to fill those holes from the end. I'll jump back to this slide. I added this image on here to this slide. This is a pretty good example of a core, you can see. So you can see here, even along this flash, the two halves of the mold open up, and each of these cooling fins is tapered away from that parting line. And so this hole you could get really for free because it's in the direction of the mold opening or the die. But this one, you have to have motion in a different direction. So this would be a core. You'd have to have a core slide that would pull out in this direction to allow this hollow shape that's not available in the draw direction. Also, holes can be a little problematic because you have this solid mass and the liquid metal has to flow around those holes without solidifying. And also, the metal as it cools will shrink down and grip on to things like these slides and these the cores that would be inside of the holes. And so it can be difficult to get those to turn loose, and sometimes you need a really pronounced draft angle to get those to release from the pins that would form the holes. Also, rounded corners are generally, in almost any type of casting, they're really the preferred thing. Metal in castings really doesn't like to make nice sharp corners. So so it's generally a good idea to add the fillets and rounds. And avoiding those, if you do cast a sharp corner, that's gonna add a stress concentration. It's gonna raise the stresses up and make the part crack more easily in that area. All right, so these are some examples of die cast parts that we have down in the lab. This is a dishwasher or a refrigerator handle, okay? And all of this other stuff that doesn't look like refrigerator or dishwasher handle is actually, you know, these are the runner system. So I'm just going to interrupt myself and go out and I added this slide in here about the runner system because I realized there's kind of a lot of stuff on here that I haven't really talked about. This place right here where the material gets squeezed into the mold is called the biscuit. And in some cases, that has more of a tapered sleeve shape and it would be called a sprue. And there's a thing called a sprue spreader in there, but let's just call that the biscuit. And then there is this runner system. So there's the main runner and then these branch runners off of that. The gate is where the metal flows into the cavity. So this main part in here would be the cavity. And then the overflow wells, and then this overflow runner system branches out, and then finally it goes through this vent. So this chill vent area is where the air is designed to be forced out of the mold as the metal goes in, and yet you don't want to keep squeezing metal out the other side, and so it's designed for the metal, you know, it's real thin, sort of a labyrinth shape that causes the metal to solidify before it can be squeezed out the other side of the mold. So the metal went in from this direction and fills out in this back direction. And you see here they've got the ejection pins located out here on this on the perimeter where that's going to get discarded. So maybe you can see the little witness mark for the ejection pins. There you go. I'll zoom in on those a little bit so you can see those. All right. So what that enables you to do, so now you can eject this part out of the mold, but the only part that's left on the finished part, the only sort of witness mark is this really tiny edge gate along this whole side. So you've got these little tiny edges on here and you're not left with an ejection mark right here on the product. So this is something that the customer is going to be handling every time they open the fridge or the dishwasher. And if they feel this little witness mark for the ejection pin, that's just going to annoy them and they're going to hate whoever manufactured this product. All right. But here they've moved it off to the side, and now that it's on the side here where they can conveniently polish that and not have any problem with the witness marks left from the ejection pins. All right, and I didn't mention, this is the overflow section over here on this side. So this is the overflow arrangement on the back side. So it gets filled from this side, and then this allows you to overfill the part and make sure that it's completely filled out and you don't wind up with voids along this back edge. Now there are two big general categories of die casting machines. There are hot chamber and cold chamber machines, and the real difference is how they get the metal from wherever it's melted into the mold. Okay, so in the hot chamber machine, this is entirely submerged down into the molten metal. This is better for lower temperature alloys. It is a faster process. This is a pretty good video here. If you've never seen a die casting machine in action, then I would suggest that you watch that. Then the other one is the cold chamber machine. So this is one arrangement of a cold chamber machine, but you can see that it's separate from where the metal gets melted. All right, so this is where you're using higher melting temperature alloys, aluminum, for example, and it's going to be a little bit slower. So in some cases, you actually ladle the molten alloy out of one container and then spoon it into the injection chamber. And that's what you see here. So this is a horizontal cold chamber machine and a vertical cold chamber machine. So sometimes, they've got a little mechanized arm that comes down, scoops out of the crucible, and pours the molten metal into the chamber, and then this will shut and it do the injection. And so there's a video in the notes there on a cold chamber machine. And then this is just kind of an overview video Probably worth watching. It's real good for some 80s nostalgia. This is the kind of stuff that they would have rolled a television into the classroom with a VHS tape and showed you stuff like that. So if you missed those days, then that's probably a really good video. All right, and then there is centrifugal casting. Again, kind of a broad category. So there are different ways of doing this. This can be done horizontally, vertically, and sometimes you're making a completely hollow shape, the way that you see here, and sometimes you're actually using the centrifugal force to drive the metal out to the outside. And what happens here is, so you pour the molten metal into this mold as it's spinning, and it's going to spread around and coat the inside of this mold, and the centrifugal force actually drives any of the porosity, the lighter weight components in the melt, to the inside, so your impurities and things will be forced to the inside because they're going to have, you know, less density than the rest of this melt. So it drives the porosity and any kind of inclusions to the inside of the mold, and then those are generally machined out. So this is what you would call true centrifugal casting, where the inside of this structure is formed strictly by centrifugal force. The only thing that's controlling the ID of this pipe is the amount of metal that you pour into the mold. On the other hand, if it's semi-centrifugal casting, you're using centrifugal force to cast the part. So this thing is spinning, and as it spins, it drives the metal out. And again, what you're after is to draw all of the impurities in here toward the center of this, and then you're going to go in and machine that out. So it works really nicely for things like railroad wheels or solid metal wheels, where you're then going to bore out an axle hole in the middle and get rid of all those impurities. So really nice way of doing that. But the distinction is that the idea of a semi-centrifugal casting is going to be formed by something other than centrifugal force, whereas true centrifugal casting, you're going to get the ID is just going to be determined by the mold and how much metal goes into the mold. And again, pretty good little video in here on centrifugal casting. Just in this little screenshot, you can see the outside of this thing looks perfectly clean. But the inside, you can see the slag and all the impurities and stuff are drawn toward the inside here. All right, another version of centrifugal casting, not really related to the others, but only in the fact that it uses centrifugal force to fill the mold, is centrifugal rubber mold casting, or sometimes called rubber spin casting, or rubber mold spin casting. So this is used for really low melting point alloys, like zinc and pewter, stuff like that, or lead. And you use a silicone rubber disc that has the mold in it, and spin this thing up and pour the liquid metal in, and it fills the mold out. So this is useful for small cast parts, like little small figurines, medallions, jewelry type applications, charms and things like that. Real low cost, not super precise necessarily, but you do get a real nice amount of detail. So a little small statuary type stuff. All right, and finally, is continuous casting. So with continuous casting, there are different versions of this, but a lot of steel products that are going to be hot rolled start life as a continuous cast product. So continuous casting is really kind of what it sounds like. You have a ladle up here at the top that is tapped at the bottom, and a lot of times this is shielded, so you have like argon shielding or something in here, and it goes down through this tube and fills this device, which is called a tundish, T-U-N-D-I-S-H, and the flow out of that tundish is controlled by this little plunger mechanism here. So that metal will flow into what's generally a water-cooled copper mold, where it will begin to solidify. But really what happens is it begins to solidify just on the outside. Here, I guess I can zoom in a little bit. All right, so it begins to solidify just on the outside from this copper mold. And what happens is it will continue to be drawn out of the mold with these set of rollers. And as it continues to draw down, It is sprayed with water and continues to cool and solidify at the bottom. Now, what happens up here with this copper mold is it's designed to be shoved sort of up and down, so it oscillates along the length of this so that it doesn't stick. All right, but then these get cut off, and they go off to be rolled in a separate process. So we'll talk about hot rolling in a couple of lectures. But a pretty good video on continuous casting. So I said that a lot of steel products are continuous cast. A lot of copper products as well. So this video is about continuous upcasting. So upcasting is a pretty unique process used to cast copper products. So you can actually cast copper into really thin sections, something like you would not be able to do with other metals. You can take copper and cast, you can basically cast wire shapes or rods that can be drawn into wire, and you can cast tube shapes. And with continuous upcasting, you can cast tubes that have interior detail, like this interior detail. So you can cast a tube, a copper tube that actually has some geometry on the inside. And this is actually, you know, maybe not this exact shape, but this type of idea is used for tubing inside of heat exchangers, where you have a lot more contact with the copper than just a circular cross section. So what happens here is you have this vat of copper, molten copper, and you'll see that it has this graphite or charcoal surface on here, which helps to deoxidize and sort of shield the copper bath. And it gets pulled up through water-cooled graphite mold and gets drawn out essentially as hollow copper tube. And it doesn't have to be hollow. You can continuous upcast solid copper bar that can then be drawn into wire shapes. So copper is kind of unique in that you can cast these really long, nice sections. All right, so that's kind of our look at permanent mold casting, and we'll see you next time.